Do not change marriage in Minnesota. Marriage is for one man and one woman. Our first speaker knows this fight very well. He has traveled all over the country proclaiming this message, and he has traveled here today to be with us. Please welcome Brian Brown, the president of National Organization for Marriage.
It's great to be back in Minnesota. It's a perfect Minnesota day, a little chilly, but not too chilly. What an honor to be here and to stand up with all of you. Some in the media are saying that those of us that believe that marriage is the union of a man and a woman in Minnesota have somehow given up. Are they right? Are we more committed than we've ever been to protecting marriage? Well, today is a critical day. We're here to stand for something so basic, so simple, so much a part of America's common sense that 15 years ago, no one would have guessed that we would have to have a rally like this or an organization like the National Organization for Marriage to stand up across the country to protect the fundamental reality that marriage is by its definition the union of one man and one woman. There's been a lot of talk about civil rights. Now, I am a student of the civil rights movement, looking at Dr. King writing from Birmingham prison, talking about the truth that a law is not a law if it is not a moral law. Now, Dr. King, he knew this from his faith. He knew this from history. He knew that the law is supposed to reflect the truth about who we are as human beings. And the truth is that children deserve the chance to have both a mother and a father. When you read in the newspapers the notion, what has become the argument, that somehow same-sex marriage is inevitable. When you read this in the papers, if you are interviewed and asked about this, realize this is not a statement of fact. This is an attempt to sap your willingness to stand up for the truth about marriage. Proponents of same-sex marriage want us to believe that this is inevitable, that this is going to come no matter what we do, so we might as well pack it up, go back to our homes, and stop fighting. We will never stop fighting for the truth. And let me say this about the election loss here in Minnesota. Let me say this, and I think it's important to address this. We were outspent by millions of dollars in this state in a sophisticated advertising campaign. That said, vote against the marriage amendment and nothing will change. Vote against the marriage amendment and the law will remain the same. You will not get same-sex marriage in Minnesota. Was that the truth? And it did not take a month until the mask was pulled off. The truth was laid bare. The voters of the state of Minnesota were sold a false bill of goods. And now, the exact opposite of what was told the voters is happening. There is an attempt, it is moving forward, as you know, in the legislature to redefine marriage. But guess what? They do not yet have the votes. I love Minnesota. They don't have the votes, and that's because folks like you are calling their legislators talking to their legislators, emailing their legislators, showing up today. The truth about history is that when people of faith have boldly and lovingly stood up for truth, they have changed the course of history. The truth about history is that there is no inevitability. The truth about history is that we together can change it. If we look back at the history of the Christian faith, and I know there are many people of faith, different faiths that have come together, and God bless all of you. But if we look at the history, if we look at the games in ancient Rome, gladiatorial combat in which human beings were sacrificed at the altar of the ability of others to have pleasure in seeing such evil. Who stood up against it? It was people of faith. They said, no, this is wrong. We will stand. They were laughed at. They were scoffed. They were told that they wouldn't have any effect. But guess what? The games were shut down. And we move to our own history. Slavery. The abolitionists, motivated by the truth about all of our human dignity. Were they welcomed? They were laughed at. They were mocked. Some were thrown in prison, and yet they stood true. And eventually, the course of history was changed. The course of our country was changed. And if we look at the civil rights movement, only a few short decades ago, this country was very different. I brought up Dr. King in the beginning. There is an attempt to hijack the legacy of the civil rights movement. My brothers and sisters in different faith, I was just down in at the meeting with the Church of God in Christ, one of the largest African-American Pentecostal churches in the country. We were talking about this. They were saying, do not allow our legacy to be hijacked. Laws against interracial marriage were wrong. Laws that protect and define marriage as the union of a man and a woman are profoundly beautiful and right, and we are going to stand for this together. Yeah. To any on either side of this debate that are inciting hatred of any kind, we need to condemn that. We are against that. But we will not accept, we will never accept the idea that the truth that marriage is the union of a man and a woman will be treated in our law like bigotry, and that we will be treated as if we're second-class citizens. We are not. We are standing for the truth, and I want all of you to realize that today you have the opportunity to meet your legislator. Do it. Go and talk to them, do it lovingly, do it boldly, stand for the truth about marriage, and we will change history together. God bless you all.
Let us pause and pray first. Gracious Father, we come in the matchless name of Jesus to tell you how much we thank you and praise you and bless your name for who you are and for all that you've done. We pray, Lord God, for continual and constant strength, that the battle will continue to be fought on your behalf. Thank you for allowing my brothers and sisters to make it from near and far. And we entrust, Lord God, that you're going to take them back home safe and sound. And in the name of he who died and rose again, even Jesus, amen. Amen. My brothers and my sisters, I would have you to know that I am a Democrat. I'm a Democrat. I say that with as much pride as I would say anything else. In case you did not know, I'm not just a Democrat, but I'm an African American. Amen. There comes a time when culture, when community, and when politics must be put aside. Whenever that which threatens the height of the biblical doctrine that we hold, someone needs to say something. The only distinction that I would share with my brother, I don't believe we lost anything in November. Because I am always of the mindset that whenever the people of God stand for the cause of God and say what God would have them to say, you never can lose. It matters not what any poll may say. God is still in control. There are those that would suggest that if we would hold to the truths of God's word, that that makes us homophobic and that makes us haters of people who choose to go that route. But I suggest to you, you are deadly wrong. It is because of the love of God that emanates from Holy Writ that we stand on the lofty highs of the love of God to share with you that you are going down a path that you really don't know anything about, and that we would dare to have you to know that the Word of God is still right and something else is still wrong. So I share with you, brothers and sisters, we've got to be vigilant. We've got to be determined. And never to let anything change us from God's definition. God knows what he's doing. I don't question his mindset. Do and be with whoever you want, but let marriage be defined by God. We cannot afford to turn around, and we got to say it from the mountaintop. We got to say it in the schools. We got to say it in the churches. We got to say it in the neighborhoods. We got to say it on the street that marriage is still defined by God, and that definition is one man and one woman.
I'm aware that there's a great deal of pain around this subject, and I'm not indifferent to that pain. I would be very willing to sit with anyone in the hearing of my voice and hear your personal story, as I've done with others in the past. That said, in addition to listening, love does its best to speak the truth and says things like, "Don't go down this road, the bridge is out." I support and I advocate one man, one woman, lifelong marriage, not because it's the natural order of things, which it is, and never in the history of the world has any culture or society as a whole gone down this path, or even attempted to, without that culture unraveling. And I don't support one man, one woman marriage because of other societal problems, and there's a whole basket full associated with them. For example, when I donate blood, I have to fill out a questionnaire that asks things like, have I ever had hepatitis? Have I ever traveled to or lived in certain places in the world? Or have I ever, since 1977, had sexual contact with another male, even once? Now, if that's on a blood donation questionnaire, when a behavior can jeopardize a community's blood supply, reservations about legalizing that behavior are warranted. But that's not why I support one man, one woman marriage. I support it because we have been given a revelation. We have a word from outside the human race about the design for the human race and for marriage within the human race. And Jesus teaches that every husband, by definition, has a wife. No wife, you're not a husband. It is the presence of the groom as a groom that makes her a bride. No groom, you're not a bride. That's just the way it works. We're not redefining anything. It's just the way it is. In Ephesians, the husband is the head of the wife as Christ is the head of the church, meaning that marriage is a picture of something other than itself. Marriage is not about my preferences. It's not about the husband or the wife. It's pointing to someone else. This is about the gospel. The church is never the head of Christ. They're not two heads. They're not no heads. There's one of each. And that's the design. The point of marriage is not us. Labeling as marriage something that is an incomplete imitation of marriage fails to establish equality between very different things that are not equal to start with. For they're not identical, and they're not made identical by relabeling. It's like Tom Hanks in the movie Castaway. You can paint a face on a soccer ball and call it Wilson, and you can have conversations with it. But beware lest you trick yourself into thinking that it's become something that it has not become. And when Hanks speaks as though Wilson is something it isn't and continues to blur distinctions, he becomes delusional. His relationship stops helping him and puts him in great peril, if you've seen the movie. Wise legislatures make good laws about false labeling, whether natural foods or what marriage is. Man-made laws do not change the natural order of things. This weekend, by legislation, we will change our clocks to daylight savings time. But the sun will still come up according to its nature. The tides will still come in and go out with total disregard for man-made laws about scheduling them. Tides are not formed around politically trendy votes in legislative bodies or anywhere else. Marriage is what it is. Please note, it's tragic enough to become an orphan on account of the unfortunate loss of one or both parents. We call that a tragedy. But for the adults around that child to systematically prevent him from having a mother or a father is another kind of tragedy. Contact your legislator and recommend that they slow down in changing these laws.
Thanks, Pastor Sam. Well, I want to tell you, it's good to be with all of you here, and I want to tell you why a 30-year-old married father of two would show up at a rotunda on a work day. I'm here because I have a word for all of you, and then because we have a word for our elected officials. I'm here because marriage in our culture needs a lot of work, and there aren't going to be any easy fixes. And when it comes to the defense of marriage, our first and fundamental calling is to be faithful at our posts, to be faithful where God has planted us. Because we cannot uphold the value of marriage as one man, one woman, one lifetime if our marriages and our families are in shambles. We cannot magnify the meaning of marriage if our own homes are being destroyed by brokenness and frustration and bitterness. If we are to revive the moral imagination of this country, and especially of our young people who are casualties and victims of the sexual revolution, then our homes and our families and our marriages must be havens of life and joy and gratitude to God, who gives us richly everything to enjoy. Our words about the beauty and sanctity of marriage will be powerful and effective only when those words flow out of strong, stable, happy families. But it's not enough for us to be faithful at our posts. We're here today because we want to call our elected officials to be faithful at their posts. We are here to remind them that they do not have the right or the authority to redefine an institution that human beings did not invent. The living God established and defined and invented marriage as a blessing for human beings, for the good of society, for the flourishing of children, as a picture of Christ and His church. And what God has defined, let no man or legislature redefine. We did not send our elected officials here to St. Paul to pretend to be God. We did not send them here to undermine fundamental institutions of society. We did not send them here to perform a social experiment on our children by defining marriage in a way that no society in the history of the world has ever defined it. But we are also here to strengthen weak hands and feeble knees, to encourage those who agree with us to maintain the integrity of their convictions in the face of charges of bigotry and intolerance, when that's not what they feel or what we feel, and that's not what we are. So we have come here from Owatonna and Edina and Maple Grove and Eden Prairie and Albert Lea and Elbow Lake and all over Minnesota to call our representatives to the courage of the high ground. Uphold marriage for the long-term health and stability of this state and this country. Uphold marriage for the flourishing and well-being of children who need a mom and a dad. And uphold marriage for the protection of our religious liberties, especially for those of us who will continue to uphold it no matter how they vote. We want to remind them, in the words of Dr. Martin Luther King, that the ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort and convenience, but where he stands at times of challenge and controversy. So to you, I say this: be faithful at your posts, love your families, cultivate gratitude and joy in your own homes, speak respectfully to your elected officials, and encourage your neighbors to do the same. And most importantly, do not grow weary in doing good. Continue to sow seeds of hope and truth in your family and community. God has promised in the Lord Jesus, our labor is never in vain. We will reap if we do not give up. Thank you and God bless.
Thank you. I'll stand up here. Thank you. Thank you all for being here. We are very appreciative of your taking the time out of your day to come down. We're right in the middle of a floor session. We're debating the insurance exchange. But I just want to tell you very briefly, they said I had 1 minute, that's all I can take here, but I just want to say that we believe that marriage is not something that legislatures created or government created. We believe that marriage is something that God created. It reflects an order that God created, and it is the thing that unites children with their parents. And the other thing that I'd like to say, that all of us up here, we oppose changing the marriage laws that we have today. We support the current law that we have. We support marriage. Thank you.
Wow. Hey, where are my peeps from Andover, Coon Rapids, and hey, guys! Thanks for coming out today. It's great to see this rotunda filled with wonderful people that are in support of marriage. Well, we believe here in the Capitol, in the legislature, that marriage is just fine the way it is in Minnesota statutes right now. And I'm so happy to see so many kids out here today, from a baby I just held a little bit ago. I'm seeing teenagers, I'm seeing young adults. And you're the reason that we're here today. We believe that marriage is defined in statute as the union between one man and one woman for a reason, because there is, government does have an interest in protecting children. You're the reason we're here. It's not about two adults, it's about the kids. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, I encourage each and every one of you to come back and support all us legislators who need your help, your prayers, your support, every time that we are here to defend marriage. Please come back. It's reassuring, it's refreshing, it's helpful, and it's energizing, and we need your help. And it's great to have you here. Come back and protect marriage. Protect marriage. God bless you all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We came here today to support the marriage. Yes. We came here today to have a happy family. Yes. We don't came here to destroy the family. Yes. Thank you very much. My name is Abdigani Ali. I am one of the imams. I'm of the Muslim community in Minneapolis. And also, I am one of the Somali American community leaders. I came here today to participate this beautiful gathering. And also, I'm really supporting that, as the saying says, marriage is only one man and woman. Yes. I'm not only me, but all my friends. I could say all the Muslim community across the country, they believe that marriage is a man and woman. So we came, thank you very much. I just want to add that government, I just want to send one message to the government. Government did not create the marriage, God created. So don't legalize what the God says no. You have to legalize and say yes, what the God says yes. Don't lie to children. See, the sign says don't lie to children. I work with the school, of the public schools. I don't really see that our kids are taking a class for the gay marriage. So we're supporting the marriage will be only one man and woman. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Roger Thompson. I'm a Christ follower and a pastor. And I have spent a good portion of my ministry life encouraging and strengthening marriages, which I define, as everyone else has defined here, as a union between a man and a woman for life. You don't need to share my biblical convictions about marriage in order to see the flawed reasoning behind redefining marriage. I want to talk to you today about marriage, that redefining it is not just a semantic tweak. It is not just an academic exercise. It is a social experiment of the greatest magnitude. And you don't have to believe me, you can look at history. History is the great laboratory that tests the ideas of legislatures and laws. And history doesn't lie to us. History shows us the results of those ideas when we look at the health of the society, the strength of families, and the prosperity of the citizens that live in those societies. And I'd like to share with you three societal experiments, all with ghastly results, that began with the seemingly simple redefinition of a word. The first example is the word ownership. About 100 years ago, it was slightly redefined by an adjective, and the adjective was collective ownership. All the countries and nations that have tried that wonderful idea have ended in poverty, in oppression, and in utter hopelessness, all because they redefined a word. The second example is the example of family. The word family has been redefined in China by the simple redefinition of one-child family. China today sits on a demographic time bomb. There's a generation that will have no social welfare, and there are 100 million or more Chinese men who will never find a wife because of the demographic imbalance in their culture. It all began with a redefinition of what a family is and what a family can be. The third brief example is the word child. Child used to be the result of conception between a man and a woman, but it's now been redefined as the product of conception. That redefinition has meant the loss of life of 55 million children in this nation over the last 40 years, and the incredible post-abortion trauma of countless millions of women. And it all began with redefining little things like words. Words matter because words carry meanings, and meanings result in all the actions, laws, and policies which we pass. We must not redefine marriage in Minnesota. It is not a social experiment. It is untested, and it is unprecedented in the history of the world. And all subsequent actions result in policies, laws, taxes, and the well-being of the people of the society. And they have unintended consequences. So defining marriage or redefining marriage is not just an academic exercise. It's not just a religious scruple. Rather, it is something that has been built into the very fabric of human life throughout history. Long before there was Christianity, though I'm a Christian, And I would argue it from my biblical beliefs, but long before Christianity, long before there was American politics, long before the Supreme Court, the Greeks, the Romans, the Asians, the Europeans, the Africans, all defined marriage as a gendered privilege for a man and a woman. Every culture has administered this value in many disparate ways, but they all agreed that they could not deny that nature and nature's God created us undeniably male and female. And therefore, their societies were enduring. All enduring cultures have recognized this inherent difference. History is the great laboratory that proves that this is reality. So there are two different visions of marriage that we are looking at here. Only one will stand the test of historic reality. Only one will bring about the goodness in society. Only one will ensure that men and women and families will live not only in peace but in prosperity in the future. And make no mistake, if we change the definition of marriage, everything in our society and everything in our families will be affected. Every school curriculum will change. Every social worker's criteria will change. Every camp, every team, every school will change. Every parent will be affected as they try to teach their own children about sexuality at an appropriate age and at an appropriate time. And make no mistake, it's not simply about same-sex marriage. It's about the redefinition of marriage. Because once we redefine it, there are no guardrails to any polyamorous or polygamous ensemble of adults who want to call themselves a marriage. We must not wager the future of Minnesota on an untested social experiment. Do not redefine marriage in Minnesota. I have been asked to lead us in a word of prayer. Will you bow your heads with me, please? I will pray using the words of Psalm 103. The steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting to those who fear him, and his righteousness to their children's children, to those who keep his commands and remember to do his covenant. The Lord has established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you for coming. You know, I know you know there's a battle going on. And the battle is not over. Nothing that happened in November means the battle is not over. But the attack is. And we have to understand that we are fighting for our children and our culture and our way of life. This has been a long road. It started with Michelle Bachmann, and it's now here. We've had a marriage amendment in November, and now we have bills before the legislature wanting to change the definition of marriage the way you understand it. I've seen the bill, and I want you to know, in the old days, meaning what's written in law right now, we make reference to man and woman. We make reference to husband and wife in our laws. But the bill before us soon will take a blotter and erase those references. There will be no reference of a husband and wife. There will be no reference of a man or woman. simply in a generic form, two people. And the battle is for school curriculums. The battle is for business relationships, because if someone doesn't comply with the law, you will be sued or held criminally liable. And of course, the greatest tragedy would be for our clergy who simply want to preach from whatever religious reference they want about framing the relationship of a man and a woman as something holy and something right and pure between a man and a woman. I want to thank you for turning out today. You know, in November, we thought it was a pretty desolate place to come back to the Capitol, but there is so much life and energy and vibrancy here. And the polls, you know, the polls that have come out. The polls are saying not even 40% of Minnesotans want same-sex marriage. That's what the polls are saying. It is not the time for Minnesota to go down that road. Thank you for coming. God bless you. The battle is not over.
We could not be more grateful that you are here today. I mean that with all my heart. I'm Senator Paul Gazelka and my wife, Marilee. You know, we've been married 30 years. Marilee and I have been married 30 years and have 5 kids. We know that marriage matters. The children that are here now and future children are counting on the success of marriage. They're counting on the success of a mom and dad marrying, working together, playing together, loving each other, forgiving each other, modeling male and female in a healthy, loving relationship. They're counting on the success of marriage. So thank you so much for coming. Keep your voice out there. Keep talking to people. Keep loving people. Keep praying for us. Don't ever give up. Don't ever give up. Thank you.
Well, the Minnesota legislature knows we're here. From the third floor to the gallery, we are here. And we are here because of some basic truths. We are here because there are brave men and women like the senators that just stood before you who will stand for right and for truth and for basic democratic process. And let's thank them just one more time. Yeah! So let's talk about some of those basic truths. Now, I have had the privilege of listening to each of these pastors and imams, and certainly the leader of my church, the Archbishop, is proud to have you here, and we are grateful. But even if they don't share our faith, there are some basic truths that we believe that they should share as Minnesotans. Article 1, Section 1 of our Constitution says that government is instituted for the benefit of the people. And the polls are clear that the people want marriage defined as the man union of one man and one woman. Now, some suggest that because not all Minnesotans voted for the amendment, that fact is in doubt. But the truth is that most Minnesotans thought that since our Constitution didn't say anything about marriage, we could rely on nature and common sense to protect the current definition. Let us be clear. This is not a fight that we picked. We didn't pass the opportunity to vote on this because we thought it was a good idea to add more words to our Constitution. We did it because of a case that is still pending in Hennepin County of Benson versus Chapman, where the other side is engaged in constitutional blackmail. We may not be judges, and we may not be legislators, but we are the people of Minnesota. And one of the truths inherent in our constitutional order is that our government is supposed to be by the people, for the people, and we are here today. So in these last few minutes together, let me just remind you, as if you need reminding, of what is at stake. It is often said, how will redefining harm your marriage? And the simple truth is, after 34 years of training, I'm not about to give him up to retrain a new one. But it will harm how my children and my fellow citizens understand marriage. In Minnesota today, over one-third of the babies born are born in a home without a dad. And the fact that the government may hunt those men down and get child support suggests that men are nothing more than a check or a wallet. And that is false. Kids need a mom and a dad. And every one of us knows that if we change the definition of marriage, we are saying to the culture, through our public schools, through our laws, and through the institutions that we establish by government, that marriage really is unrelated to children. That marriage is about adult affection, adult sexual preference. It's not about undertaking a lifelong commitment of love, a unique love, a love unlike the love of a brother and a sister or a parent and a child, but a love that is creative and brings new life into being and obligates us to be faithful to our promises in good times and in bad. Now, I don't say the people can't make mistakes. We made a big one when we agreed to no-fault divorce. And we're paying the wages of that. You know that there is only 1.75 marriage licenses for every divorce decree issued in this state? Do you know that a child being raised in a single-parent home has nine times greater chance of living in poverty than a child living with their mom and dad? I confess to you, my brothers and sisters, that we have sinned through our fault through our fault, through our most grievous fault. But that doesn't mean we're about ready to make another mistake. We are here to strengthen marriage, not redefine it. Tell them that kids need a mom and a dad. And tell them we care about all the kids of Minnesota. Including the less than 2,000 families being raised by single-sex parents. We care about all Minnesotans, including our brothers and sisters and fellow citizens standing upstairs. But their parenting skills won't be enhanced by redefining marriage. Their children won't be protected from the sort of cultural decay that we have set in motion by no-fault divorce and a lack of faithfulness to our promises. Their children and their relationships don't win if we lose. The only thing that can happen is if we both win, and we both win when we strengthen marriage, not redefine it. So at each of these doors today, you will find materials that will help you. You will find young volunteers who are eager to see the next generation raised with a mom and a dad standing there to help you learn how to talk to your representatives. But don't forget the most basic truth. We are citizens. We have a right to have our say. Go talk to them. Talk to your fellow citizens, and then storm the gates of heaven with your prayers, and we will win! Thank you. God bless you. Go about our work together. Thank you.